What's up, lore masters? We'll be taking a look at the Battle of the Binary Stars today. In 2256, the USS Shenzhou was dispatched to investigate a damaged interstellar relay on the edge of Federation space, near the Klingon border. While attempting to determine the cause of the damage that the relay had received, scanners began to have erratic readings with no ability to pinpoint what exactly was causing them. There was an anomaly out there, but none of the ship's sensors could identify what it was. In order to determine what this anomaly was, Executive Officer Michael Burnham was sent out to investigate. Given her previous experience, it only made logical sense. Going out in a spacesuit, she approached the anomaly and ultimately landed upon it, against orders. She discovered that it was a Klingon vessel. Michael Burnham was attacked almost instantly by one of the Klingons who apparently had been on the ship or came out once she landed, and was able to defend herself, killing the aggressor. She quickly launched off the ship and barely made it back to her own due to injuries sustained in space and in the battle. Upon realizing that there were Klingons within Federation space, Captain Philippa Giorgio sent out a distress call to any available Federation ship. Wishing to unite the 24 houses of the Klingon Empire, Klingon warrior Captain T'Kuvma activated the Light of Kalis, a beacon that would make the ship so bright that even with dampening technology, the light would still glare through the windows of the USS Shenzhou. In only a short amount of time, 24 Klingon vessels would drop out of warp in front of the Shenzhou, and T'Kuvma would attempt to persuade the houses to join him in a holy crusade against the Federation. Ultimately, 10 Starfleet vessels would arrive to reinforce the USS Shenzhou, and Captain Giorgio would hail the Klingon fleet. T'Kuvma would use her words against her, attempting to make the captain and the Federation look like they wished to force the Klingons to become a part of their organization, to remove what it was to be a Klingon. T'Kuvma would unite the Klingons using a phrase, "Klingons first." After the Shenzhou's captain would reach out an olive branch, the Klingon forces would open fire upon Starfleet forces. Now before we get into the battle proper, let's do a breakdown of the ships. If you're not interested, you can go to the timestamp here, but let me assure you, they don't really tell us much about the ships. So I'll be giving you the name of the ships and possibly the class, but no technical breakdowns. Seriously, I had more to go on with the Orville. I was kind of disappointed. For the Klingons, we know that they had at least a few birds of prey. I believe I saw that they would also have what they classify as D7s and the sarcophagus ship. The sarcophagus ship was significantly larger than most all Starfleet ships. It dwarfed the Federation's Walker-class starship as an example. The ship also held superior firepower, able to inflict significant damage in a short amount of time. The sarcophagus ship also held armor in the form of caskets of the dead crew members that once lived upon it. Supposedly, even those from thousands of years ago. The ship had directed energy weapons and torpedoes with enough firepower to destroy the surface of a Class M planet. Starfleet would boast at least 10 ships, and possibly more, especially when the Europa arrived. These ships would include the USS Clark, Malachowski class, USS Dana, Hoover class, USS Earhart, possibly Malachowski class or Ingle class, USS Edison, Hoover class, USS Ride, Shepard class. USS Shenzhou, Walker class. USS Kerala, Shepard class. USS Shran, Maggi class. The USS Sioux, Malachowski or Ingle class. USS T'Plana Hoth, Ingle class. USS Jaeger, Cardanus class. And the USS Europa would arrive late into the battle, Nimitz class. As stated before, the Klingon fleet would begin firing on the ships after the attempt at peace by the captain of the USS Shenzhou. The sarcophagus ship and several other vessels would focus fire on the Shenzhou itself, inflicting massive damage on the vessel. The Shenzhou would turn and duck down as the USS Sioux and several other ships would fly over to flank and open fire, giving cover for the besieged ship. The Starfleet line would begin to disintegrate almost immediately. While most Starfleet ships appeared to be matched technologically with their Klingon counterparts, the presence of the sarcophagus ship, along with Klingon veterans versus Starfleet officers who'd barely seen combat, if at all, gave the Klingons a huge edge. Starfleet would be able to destroy several Klingon ships, but mostly be playing a defensive game during this battle. As the Klingon ships continued to obliterate Starfleet's line of defense, the USS T'Plana Hoth would find itself under attack from multiple ships on multiple vectors. The USS Shenzhou, finally recovering, would respond and come to the aid of the T'Plana Hoth, destroying at least one vessel and drawing the fire of the others. This would come at a cost, however, as the USS Shenzhou would have multiple breaches on decks 1, 2, and 6 through 9, which honestly would seem to be a big deal since the bridge was on deck 7, where a breach was supposedly happening. Ultimately, the USS Shenzhou would be knocked out of the fight and left to drift into several rocks. It would be saved by the USS Europa, who would have arrived very late. Admiral Brett Anderson of the Europa would save the Shenzhou from slamming into the asteroids by using its tractor beam. The Admiral would call for a ceasefire to Takuvma over subspace communications. Takuvma would acknowledge and a brief cessation of hostilities would occur. This would only be a ploy by Takuvma, however, as he would use a similar technology that would create an invisibility shield around one of his ships. This would mean that Starfleet vessels would be unable to detect the ship as it slammed into the Europa, cutting it like butter. The Europa would self-destruct, sacrificing itself in order to destroy this new ship. The Klingon fleet would begin attacking the Federation fleet again, the Federation fleet being forced to withdraw. The Battle of the Binary Stars would be a decisive victory for the Klingon Empire. At least 7 ships would be destroyed, including the USS Edison, USS Clark, USS Europa, USS Shenzhou, USS Shran, USS Teplana Hoth, and USS Jaeger. The Klingons would take casualties as well, including the Klingon Cleave ship, which was one of only 2 ships that had the quote-unquote invisibility cloak, several birds of prey, and after the battle, the sarcophagus ship would be heavily damaged as well due to Starfleet ingenuity. The conflict would soon become known as the Battle of the Binary Stars, sometimes mislabeled Battle at the Binary Stars, or the shorthand, Battle of the Binaries. The confrontation would cost the lives of thousands of Starfleet officers and a huge victory for the Klingons. Takuvma would have united the 24 houses and demoralized Starfleet. The Klingon Federation War would have begun, and would have already been going very poorly for the Federation.